on a great Wellington day. You can't beat Wellington on a great day. In fact, it's very difficult to beat Wellington full stop, unlike what other people will say about it. So it's lovely to be here. Thank you very much for coming out. And I just wanted to explain, as Anita said, about where we are going as a Labour Party in regards to the way we set our agenda for the budget. You know, a few weeks ago, a woman contacted me and asked for help. And she and a partner told me that they both have jobs, they pay their bills, they pay their mortgage, and they're raising four kids. But they're struggling to get by week after week. And she told me that her situation is now desperate. Her partner even actually went to Christchurch to try and see if he could find extra work and earn a bit more. Just the other week, their car needed four new tyres to pass the warrant. That used up the little savings that they had, and they had to borrow from a friend. She said, and I quote what she said to me, "We feel like bad role models for our children because we're constantly struggling." What she told me, they're about as good a role model as anyone can be. And I have the utmost respect for people like that. It's not right, though, and it's not fair that it's so hard to raise a family here in New Zealand. She's been let down and she's been left behind by this government. John Key isn't interested in the problems faced by hard-working families because he's too focused on the share floats to care about Kiwis who are working their guts out to make ends meet. He's more focused on his mates than your mates. So it'll be no surprise to you when Bill English delivers his fifth budget next week, and you know there'll be something missing. People. People. You'll hear a lot about glossy business growth agendas and progress reports, but there won't be anything there to help you find a job or get a better job, to help you buy a house, to help you pay your bills, or to stop you and your family and your children from moving to Australia. Because that is this government's record. This government makes promise after promise in budget after budget, but it hasn't delivered. So why would you believe them this year when that's their record? Let's take a look at that scorecard. John Key had promised he'd give Kiwis a reason to stay in this country. Last week, the 200,000th person left for Australia since he came to power. At the last election, he promised 170,000 jobs. That's less than 18 months ago. But in the last year, there were 30,000 fewer. There are more than 163,000 people now unemployed. In budget 2010, they promised higher incomes. But since John Key's been in office, rising prices have outstripped pay packets. In 2007, this is going back a bit, he promised to help, quote, "our growing underclass." But income inequality in New Zealand is now the highest since records began. The highest since records began. There are now almost 24,000 more people on benefits, and 21% of kids are living in poverty, up from 15%. Under his watch, the gap between the top 10% and the rest of New Zealand is widening faster and faster. And he promised to close the wage gap with Australia too, but New Zealanders are now earning an average of $58 a week less than their neighbours across the Tasman. That gap's grown as well. In the 2010 budget, he promised a step change in the economy. Instead, he's delivered a step back for so many people. John Key once said he was ambitious for New Zealand. I haven't heard that for a while. The only thing he's ambitious about now is coming up with more and more excuses about why things haven't been working. And you'll have heard yesterday that he's certainly not ambitious for Wellington. In fact, he's signed its death warrant, it seems to me. It's, talk about absolutely negatively John Key. So this budget won't change your life. It's a budget for the boardroom and not the smoko room. The national government spends more time looking after vested interests than your interests. It's too busy doing backroom deals with gambling houses, movie giants, to make sure that hardworking New Zealanders have the wages that they need to live on. Too busy protecting the super profits of the power companies, for example, to worry about bringing your power bills down. Too busy selling our assets to find innovative ways of growing our economy. So who is this government actually working for? Investment bankers? Casino operators? Property speculators? And if you're lucky enough to be a director of a power company, you would have just got a 73% rise in what you're earning. And you're going to be earning $1,200 a day on special expenses allowance as well. That's good. That's good work if you can get it. But it's not going to be for you and your family. Now, we know times have been tough, and we know that, but our main trading partners have turned a corner, and the question is, why haven't we? The reason is that this government has got its priorities wrong. I believe New Zealand can do better, but we need to change. We need to change. We can't continue as we are, stagnating and sliding down the global rankings. We need to change New Zealand for the better, so that it works in the interests of all its people. My vision for New Zealand is a place where people know they can get ahead, a place where the world would want to live, and a place we can all be proud of. A place that rewards talent and hard work, it puts a premium on innovation. To do that, we've got to be forward-looking and to find ways of creating a country of drive and opportunity. And that's why I will lead a government focused on what works for you and your family. A government that's prepared to change things that aren't working. I believe in New Zealand. I believe in New Zealand. But we've got to do better. And we can. By unlocking the opportunities for everyone through a better education. By creating a stronger economy built on skills, creativity, science, hard graft, and our natural advantages. By building a strong export-led economy. I say, if you're doing your bit, we should do ours in government as a government for the people. Because you should be rewarded for your talent and hard work, and not because you just happen to be somebody's mate. That's the guts of the difference between John Key and me. My government will put people at the heart of everything that we do. National's forgotten the people who are the backbone of this country. I recently met the Nobel Prize winning economist Joseph Stiglitz in New York. And he's shown a number of papers that he's put out that growing inequality is the number one factor that is holding back countries like New Zealand. New Zealand was once one of the most equal societies in the world. And we're actually very proud of that. But that's no longer the case now. Now the gap between the top 10% and the rest is widening faster than most other Western nations. National's tax switch in 2010 made it worse, and the top 10% of earners took home 40% of that money. You can see it on the graph. That's a bonus of $2.25 billion in their pockets. $2.25 billion. And that flies in the face of everything that we know, that an equal society is a fairer society. But just as importantly, closing that gap helps everyone to get ahead and to stay ahead. Because as Joseph Stiglitz has shown and spoke to me about, inequality, as he says, is bad for business. It's bad for business. My mechanic, for example, earns a decent income but hasn't been able to get a pay rise for the past 4 years. He's been squeezed like so many other hard-working New Zealanders. Now, if people like him have nothing left at the end of the week, then they have nothing to spend, nothing to invest, and nothing to save. That's not good for those workers, it's not good for business, and it's not good for our economy as a whole. This is not rocket science. This is really basic economics that Joseph Stiglitz is reawakening us to. So we need to change. We need to shift our economy to an economy that works for us all. And as a Prime Minister, I want to create and build, not just trade and sell. I want an economy that grows businesses and creates high-value jobs that keeps our talented people right here. It's time for new bold ideas that improve lives without pushing our country into debt. It's time for a government that's a smart, hands-on and government that uses the power it has to make a real difference. We will be prudent, responsible managers of our country's finances. We will balance our budgets. I grew up in a Presbyterian household where we didn't put things on tick, and we were reminded constantly that you saved up and you lived within your means. That was what my parents taught me. That's what sort of the example they led. So I understand how important that is, and Labour understands that as well. You know, the last Labour government produced budget surpluses 9 years in a row. It left us with amongst the lowest government debt in the world. It's a pretty respectable record. When this government took over, the books were in surplus. Since then, every year, year after year, the government has been in deficit. This year, we will be almost $8 billion short. That means our government debt, net government debt today, is $58 billion. $58 billion in debt. Now, as a country, we must live within our means. We can't go on spending what we don't have. And that's why we need a smart, active government to make changes that will benefit people and boost our economy. And that's what the next Labour government will do. And I want to give you two examples of that. NZ Power. It's the announcement we made just a few weeks ago. It's a plan that will reduce household power bills down by between $230 to $330 a year, and it will limit future power increases. That makes a big difference, because power prices have gone through the roof in New Zealand. You're being ripped off. Look at that compared to those other countries in comparison. One woman wrote to me this week to say she and her husband have just had their first child. She wants to do the best by her new family, but she said she feels, as she put it, physically sick with worry each time she checks the mailbox for her power bill. She says, and I quote her, "Parents in New Zealand shouldn't feel worried about the basic necessities for their children, such as electricity. It makes you feel hopeless." She shouldn't need to feel hopeless. starting off a new family, lots of hope, lots of enthusiasm for the future. Now, NZ Power can change that. It'll put money back into the hands of people struggling to make ends meet. And that's good for the economy as well, because cutting power bills will put cash into the pockets of Kiwis and businesses. And again, the money they spend, that's the money that they will spend and the money that they will invest. The independent economist Burl says that that extra spending that those people have in their hands will stimulate our economy, boost GDP by about $450 million a year, and create 5,000 extra jobs. So there's real win-win-win here with power bills. John Key says that power prices aren't too high. And no wonder he's not prepared to act on them. Well, I'd say he is out of touch and not listening to Kiwis, because that's what I hear when I go around the country. That's certainly what people tell me. Instead, I think what he's doing is listening to the power companies and the share brokers who are protecting their own patch. And I say to them, you can choose to buy shares, but you can't choose to buy electricity. You should earn a fair return, but not a super profit. It's that simple. It really is that simple. So if those big vested interests want to stop consumers getting a better deal and stop our economy getting a boost, well then, bring it on. Because I'm not about to sit around and let that happen. Let me give you one further example. Kiwi Build. House prices are rocketing up. We heard that again in the news today. And that's why we've come up with an innovative way to help 100,000 families into affordable homes. It means building houses, bricks and mortar, not just fiddling around with the RMA or pushing the blame onto the council for what they might not be doing. Operating on that sort of a scale, 10,000 houses a year, means that our construction companies can make huge savings. And over time, the program funds itself. Tomorrow, we have a meeting with many of those construction companies and architects, sit around and put some flesh on the bones of KiwiBuild. And we are very encouraged by the number of people and number of companies and individuals that have approached us about wanting to get in behind it. And again, it's good for our economy. It creates thousands of jobs and hundreds of apprenticeships. It's another example of how my government will be smart and hands-on. So Labor policies will help all New Zealanders, not just the rich and the connected. Our policies are practical and they put people first. We need to create those opportunities, because it's the only way we can really tackle this growing inequality that we see in our country. We'll start by giving our kids a world-class education, a great head start. It's the number one in terms of bringing that gap, the inequality gap, together. So we'll extend our reading recovery out to all schools, not just those in the high deciles. We'll put food in school so that kids are ready to come, when they come to school, to learn. We'll help them to discover what they want to do with their lives and make sure that when they leave school, they know where they're going. We'll make sure that people get a decent wage, lift the minimum wage to $15 an hour, and champion a living wage so that people can provide for their family. Our future should be a high-wage economy and not a low-wage economy. Right across the economy, we will make fundamental changes that will transform the economy to grow export businesses and create high-value jobs. So, monetary policy will change. We'll broaden the objectives of the Reserve Bank to wider than just inflation, because our high dollar that keeps going up is killing our export businesses. The research and development policy will change because R&D tax credits will help our smart businesses grow and sell our products to the world. The tax system will change. We want to shift. We want to shift investment from speculation that's helping to drive up our house prices to our productive businesses. And that's why we'll introduce our capital gains tax. We're only one of two countries in the OECD that doesn't have one. The savings policy will change. We'll enrol everyone into KiwiSaver to secure Kiwi's future retirement and build an investment pool to power the businesses that need to get ahead. We'll give Kiwi companies the first crack at the big government contracts, and in return, we'll expect those companies who get those contracts to hire trainees and apprenticeships. And we'll pay employers the equivalent of the dole to take on an unemployed person as an apprentice. It costs nothing. I'd love this government to pick this policy up. I mean, why don't they? And there's more to come. We have the courage to make the big changes this government is afraid to make. Changes that will transform the economy for everyone. So we have two very different paths before us. One path, under National, leads to disappointment, decline, constant struggle, where Kiwis fall behind the rest of the world. Led by a government that's consumed by scandal, broken promises, and one that sides with its mates and vested interests. Or a Labour government that puts you first, that has the courage to make the big changes to improve your life, that will back New Zealanders who are doing their bit. My first budget will be about hope. It will be about giving hardworking families a reason to believe that things will get better. It will give young Kiwis opportunities and a reason to stay here in New Zealand. It will give families a decent life where their kids can reach their full potential. It will give businesses the backing they need to flourish. But people are my priority. People. And at the end of the day, it comes down to a simple question: who do you have faith in? Well, I put my faith in New Zealanders, in their can-do attitude, their gutsy approach to life, and their willingness to do the hard graft. And as Prime Minister, I'll back you. I will make the change to a prosperous society, a fairer society, and a country we can all be proud of. Thank you very much.